it's easy to think about taste in terms of pleasure. But frankly, pleasure itself is a product of survival. So, you know, what do we tend to like? We like food and sex. What are they about? They're about survival.
These days, many of us don't think too much about the survival aspect of food. More often, it's about convenience and taste.
Ready-to-eat food is just so convenient and it's so readily available in the U.S. That I think a lot of people sort of stop paying attention to what they're putting in their bodies. I'm Kenji Lopez-Alt. I'm the Managing Culinary Director of Serious Eats. I see this hamburger in front of me that looks tasty, I'll just eat it. And you don't stop and think about, okay, like, well, what are all the things that went into making that hamburger? And are those things that if I saw the raw ingredients and I was gonna go to the supermarket, would I buy those things myself and put them together in that way? Probably not.
What we eat can play a bigger role in our health than genetics, at least according to one famous study.
Nijo Sanh, which followed Japanese from Japan to Honolulu to San Francisco. You know, essentially what happened is the Japanese in Japan had the epidemiology of Japanese. They didn't get much chronic disease. They moved to Honolulu and their health went south. I mean, they started to get some chronic disease. They started to be more vulnerable to obesity, but not too bad. And then they came to the mainland and they looked just like the rest of us. Well, obviously their genes hadn't changed as they crossed the ocean. Their culture had and their environment had.
And their diet had. Worldwide, the desire for convenience at a value has led to a huge boom in mass food processing. But fiddling with our food has been about more than just ease for the consumer.
Essentially, the processing of food isn't just to make it safe or shelf stable. Processing of food is to maximize profit by maximizing the eating we do before we feel full.
Take cheese puffs, a snack exquisitely designed to zing a bunch of different pleasure centers. Their most ingenious feature is what food scientist Stephen Witherly calls vanishing caloric density. Basically, it's the melt-in-your-mouth quality of cheese puffs that makes them disappear super fast, which tricks your brain into thinking, calories? What calories?
Design foods that get as close as possible to the bliss point. You know, basically the properties of a food where people cannot stop eating it. When we say bet you can't eat just one, we want to know that we can take it to the bank.
So how do we avoid overstuffing ourselves with perfectly engineered techno foods? Here's one idea, cooking.
You know, cooking, it involves all the senses. Like, you're listening to things, you're seeing things, you're smelling things, and then obviously you're tasting things as you go. In your head, you know what the good foods and the bad foods are, and when you cook, you're forced to think about what's going into your body, and you're forced to think about, you know, every time you pick up an ingredient, you're like, okay, like, I'm adding this to the pot, that's eventually gonna go into my body. Like, is this something I want in my body or not?
Figuring out what's good for you and what's not doesn't have to be rocket science.
The basic theme of optimal eating is absolutely clear. Mostly vegetables, fruits, whole grains, beans, lentils, nuts, and seeds, water when thirsty. But the single diet that's best, high fat, low fat, high carb, low carb, very low protein, moderate protein, vegan, paleo, it's all just somebody's pet theory.
So when it comes to healthy eating, stay simple. Keep processed, mass-produced foods to a minimum and get to know what you're putting into your system by spending some quality time in the kitchen.
And you're 100 years old, right?
I am 100 years old, right. 102, actually, yeah.